Hi. So we introduce elliptic functions in this video. So we already know what is a periodic function. So by a simply periodic function, what I mean is that you have a period, a non-zero period, and all the other periods are simply integer multiples of this period. It can be easily noticed that if omega is a period, then any integer multiple is also a period. So now, if these are the only periods, then we say that the function is simply periodic. Now, what we do, we will see that an example for a simply periodic function with period omega not equal to 0 is given by this, f of z equal to exponential 2 pi I z by omega. Now, if you consider this function, the set of all periods of f z is simply integer multiples of omega. What we are going to see first is that any function with period omega can be expressed in terms of this exponential function. This is rather easy. So what we do, you start from a region omega with the property that if z is in omega, then z plus or minus omega will be there. So that we can consider f of z plus omega and f of z minus omega. So, and omega prime is a range of omega under the map exponential 2 pi I z by omega. That means if omega is a whole quadrant spin, omega prime is c minus 0. And if omega is the strip given by this, then omega prime is the annulus obtained like this. Now, you start from a meromorphic function on omega with period omega, small omega not equal to 0. And you can define capital F on omega prime in this way. Capital F of zeta, zeta is an element here. So any element in omega prime is the image of this function exponential. So it is of the form exponential 2 pi I z by omega, since omega prime is the range of omega under this max zeta. But this z need not be unique. You know that if z satisfies this, z plus omega will also satisfy this. So, but the problem is that the good thing is that this small f is periodic with period omega. We are starting from such a function, therefore this is well defined. So corresponding to each small f, you get a capital F on omega prime, which is again a meromorphic function. Now the converse is also true. If you start from a meromorphic function capital F on omega prime, then this definition will give you a periodic function on omega. So hence each meromorphic periodic function f on omega corresponds to a meromorphic function on omega prime. Now, if we assume that omega prime consists of an annulus where this capital F has no poles, then you can consider the Lorentz expansion in that annulus like this, and by our definitions, f of z will be this. So, hence we get f, the periodic function on omega, in terms of this function, exponential 2 pi I and z by omega. This is actually the Fourier development. Now, let us consider a special situation. Suppose omega is a whole complex plane, then omega prime is z minus 0. Then f zeta has isolated singularities at 0 and infinity. So suppose the special situation where both these singularities are non-essential singularities, that means either pole or removable singularities, then simple thing is that a meromorphic function on the extended complex plane is rational, is a rational function. Therefore, this capital F will become a rational function. Now, for a rational function, for example, for a rational function, if it is of the form quotient of pz and qz, then order of f is defined to be the maximum of the degrees of p and q. Now, we define order of the small f, you define it to be the order of the capital F in this situation, okay? So, we know that a rational function assumes every complex value, including infinity, the same number of times, counting multiplicity. Now, from this identification, you get that small f will also have this has the same property. But you should identify z and z plus omega to be the same. Otherwise, there will be infinitely many points. So, if you define an equivalence relation in this way, that means z and z plus n omega related, then f is as if f is of order m, then each point other than f of 0 and f infinity is assumed exactly at m inequivalent points. So now, what about those points f of 0 and f of infinity? If imaginary part of z by omega tends to minus infinity or plus infinity, corresponding a small f z will tend to capital F0 and f of infinity respectively. So hence these points also are assumed in a limiting sense. So this is the case of simply periodic function. Now let us look at the doubly periodic function. So this is called elliptic function. So a periodic function is called doubly periodic if it has two non-zero periods omega 1 and omega 2, such that all other periods are integer combinations of these periods. And it should be noted that this for a periodic function, you have these are the choices for you. If omega is so, you if you consider the set of all periods of fz, then you denote it by m. Then if omega belongs to m, any integer multiple is also in omega, also in m. And if omega 1 and omega 2 are in m, then omega 1 plus omega 2 is also in omega. Or in other words, an integer combination of omega 1 and omega 2 will be again in m. So if f is doubly periodic, what happens? It should be all the periods should be generated by two periods, omega 1 and omega 2, which are not linearly dependent. So that means they are not integer multiples of the same period omega. So now a set with this property, that means there is an addition and a scalar multiplication, but scalars are coming from some ring, is called a module. It is just like a vector space, but underlying is not a field, but instead you have a ring. So here this set of all periods of a function fz forms a ring vector space or module. This is called the periodic module, period module. Now let us understand some properties of this. So first thing is that all the points in M are isolated points. That is easy because we are considering only f to be Meromorphic function on the whole complex plane Z. So it is we know that it is a ratio quotient of two analytic functions. Therefore, you can apply the identity theorem. So if there are some accumulation points, you know that f of omega will be equal to f of 0 for all omega belongs to m. So if there is an accumulation point, that means the f should be identically equal to this f of the value f of 0. So that is an application of identity theorem. So what happens is that if f is not constant, all the points in M are isolated. Now this theorem characterizes all the possibilities of M. I mean, if you consider a discrete module M, then these are the three choices. Either M is trivial 0, or M will consist of all integer multiples of precisely the integer multiples of some omega non-zero, or in the third possibility, M will be the set of all n1 omega 1 plus n2 omega 2, where ni's are integers and omega 1 and omega 2 are periods which are linearly independent. That means omega 2 by omega 1 does not belong to R. This is rather easy to prove. If M not equal to 0, there exists an omega in M which is non-zero. Now you can see that if you choose R to be greater than absolute value of omega, you look at the disk of radius R, intersect it with M, then it will be a finite set, because if there are infinitely many elements here, it will have an accumulation one because this is a bounded set. So this is a finite non-empty set, and hence you can consider an element here with minimum absolute absolute value. So that's what we choose to be omega 1. So just like this. Similarly, now you consider n omega 1 with n belongs to integer, this will be a subset of M, because if omega 1 is a period, all integer multiples will be a period of f. Now if M is exactly equal to this, then we are done. Now if not, then there exists some omega 2 here, some omega here with the property that omega not equal to integer multiple of omega 1. Now again you do the same process and obtain omega 2, which is of minimum absolute value among this set. So now the claim is that omega 2 and for earlier chosen omega 1 has the property that omega 2 by omega 1 does not belong to R. Because if it is in R, then it will lie between two integers n and n plus 1, strictly between them, because if equality holds, it will be an integer multiple of omega 2. So that will give you these inequalities. these inequalities will trivially lead you to a contradiction that mod omega n1 n omega 1 minus omega 2 is less than, strictly less than mod omega 1. This is contradiction to the choice of omega 1. Finally, hence the claim. So final thing is that we are going to prove that m is equal to n1 omega 1 plus n2 omega 2 with ni belongs to integers. Since C is a two-dimensional vector space over R, omega 1 omega 2 are linearly independent, it forms a basis, and any element in C is a linear combination of that. In particular, any omega belongs to M will be a linear combination of that with this. We are considering C over R, so this lambda is a real. So now, what happens? We are going to prove that they are integers. We know that there exist integers M1 and M2 such that modulus of lambda 1 minus M1 less than or equal to half n. So just choose the integer which is close to lambda 1. So then you will obtain this. Now we consider, now this M1 omega 1 plus M2 omega 2 is in M. We are going to prove that omega is actually equal to this. So for that we consider this omega prime equal to omega minus this. Now you can, from some simple inequalities, we will get that the contradiction that this omega prime has absolute value strictly less than absolute value of omega 2. So this contradiction will lead you to the fact that this is 0, therefore omega equal to M1 omega 1 plus M2 omega 2. So hence the proof. Now finally we introduce the unimodular transformation, which are actually the transformation which takes one basis to another basis in this case. If M, so F is a doubly periodic function means M is of this form. We only exactly the third alternate happens. So any pair with this property is called a basis for M. Now suppose there are two bases, then from this linear equation they are connected by this matrix ABCD, and you can prove that, you can prove this identity. First you apply the property that omega 1 omega 2 is a basis. Now you apply the property that omega 1 prime omega 2 prime is also a basis. You get two matrices A, B, C, D and A prime, B prime, C prime, D prime, which satisfy this identity, okay? And this identity, since this is an invertible matrix, you'll get that this A prime, B prime, C prime, D prime is the inverse of A, B, C, D. And that will tell you that determinant of A, B, C, D is equal to plus or minus 1. And this transformation is called unimodular transformation. So any two bases of same period module are connected by this unimodular transformation. And geometrically you will get that if you consider the parallelogram, parallelogram in the lattice formed by the elements of M, I mean using the order, with sides omega 1 and omega 2 will be sides of some parallelogram, and that will have the same area of the parallelogram with sides omega 1 prime and omega 2 prime, because the transformation which takes is a unimodular transformation. If you apply a singular value decomposition or something, you will get that that is a combination of rotation, reflection and scaling by by a matrix with determinant 1, a diagonal matrix with determinant 1, therefore the area will not be changed. That's all.